Thank you, Mr. Willoughby and students. The Assembly may be seated. I would like to introduce our chairperson for the day, Guy Brazel and Erin McCormick.
Distinguished guests, parents, Mr. Marindorf, and members of Moray Technology High School, good morning and welcome to our commemoration of Anzac Day. This morning, we are pleased to have with us those people who have fought for our country and gained for us the freedom we enjoy today. Present this morning is Mr. Larry Sykes, Mr. David Borton, Mr. John Rushbourne, Mr. Charles Morrison, Mr. Barry Lettenham, Mr. Neil Marindorf, Mrs. Paula Barton, and Mr. McLean. We have received apologies from Mr. Ian Wilson, Superintendent of Schools, and Mr. Laurie Hill. I would now like to invite Mr. Rushbourne to deliver the occasional address.
Good morning, students. Distinguished guests, principals, staff, and students. Today, we are here to commemorate Anzac Day. Now, Anzac Day is a special day. It is a public holiday, but you do have various public holidays during the year, which don't have a major significance, except possibly the religious ones, which Christmas Day and Good Friday. But Anzac Day has particular significance to all Australians. It is an immortal day when we commemorate the young men and women of Australia and New Zealand, of course, who volunteered to aid Britain in her time of trouble in the First Great War of 1914. We also commemorate those sons and daughters who answered the call without question in World War II, Korea, Malaya, Vietnam, and those peacekeeping forces in various parts of the world. It has been said that Australia became a nation in 1915. After the conflict on Gallipoli, what a price was paid with thousands of young Australians and New Zealanders giving their lives. Many more wounded. Figures show that more than 11,000 were killed and 24,000 injured in this conflict. In military terms, the landing at Gallipoli was a debacle. As an expression of war, and in human terms, a disaster. One may win a war, but it is nevertheless a failure. It reflects our inability to work out a sensible and peaceful solution to our problems, to compromise and then accept the points of view of others. Some people say we should not commemorate Anzac Day by remembering a bloody disaster, but Anzac Day is a day for us to remember and immortalise. For those Anzacs who, through their courage and tenacity, won the respect of the enemy and allies alike. At the service held in Gallipoli in 2000, thousands of Turkish nationals who were our enemies in 1915 joined with the Australian and New Zealand contingent to commemorate Anzac Day. If we can remember the lessons of war, the bloodshed and terror, we shall become a greater nation, a nation of proud Australians. Even though now we have a mixture of over 100 nationalities in Australia, we must remember that we are all Australians first. Be proud to be an Australian. Please attend the commemorative service on Anzac Day in Barlow Street on Wednesday morning, the 25th of April. Show your allegiance to the Australian flag, the Australian wildlife, and your loyalty to be an Australian, and be proud to wave the Australian flag.
Thank you, Mr. Rushmore, for speaking to us this morning. We are now going to hear an Etude form for release by Beethoven. Thank you, Annette. I'd like to introduce Mr. Larry Sykes, representing the Moray Services Club, who is presenting some verses to our students.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's my great pleasure to present these bursaries to two students of this school from the Moray District Services Club. These bursaries would enable these students to continue their schooling and continue with their chosen career path. And it is, as I've said, a great pleasure to present these on behalf of the club. The first one, Kirkby Maidens. And the other one, yes. While Kirby's coming up, I'd impress upon any new students that try and put in for one of these bursaries. The club's only too glad to make the money available. the other recipient is Rebecca LaHaye. I'm sure these two young ladies will take full benefit of this, these bursaries. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Mr. Sykes, for presenting the bursary so kindly donated by the Moray Services Club. We are now going to have Kylie Swan read to us her thoughts about Anzac Day.
What does Anzac stand for? The acronym Anzac means Australian and New Zealand Army Corps. The landing on the shores of Gallipoli on the 25th of April 1915 was the first major military operation in which the new Australian Commonwealth was involved. Because of this, it has been regarded as the fire of the new nation. It is a day of which Australians are very proud. Anzac Day has also become the day on which we remember all Australians who have served in all wars in which Australia has been involved. At dawn on the 25th of April 1915, Australian and New Zealand soldiers landed on the shores of Gallipoli Peninsula. They were part of an armed force made up of soldiers from several nations of the British Empire, including Britain and India and its ally France. Thus began an 8-month-long campaign which ended with the evacuation of all troops in December 1915.
I'm the proud grandson of Private Douglas Stuart Moore, who served in the Australian Army from the 11th of March 1942 to the 6th of June 1946. My grandfather received a number of decorations and medals. He received the 1939 to 45 Star, Pacific Star, War and Australia Services Medals. My family and I are very proud of my grandfather.
My name is Marie O'Neill and I am the proud granddaughter of George Percy O'Neill, who in 1940 was a gunner in World War II. Previous to that, he served 12 months national service in Australia, then fought overseas in Borneo, Malaya and Papua New Guinea, where there he was also awarded 4 medals. My grandfather, while fighting overseas, also contracted malaria and was wounded, which left him a physical disability up until he died at the age of 50. On returning to Australia, he married his sweetheart, Irma Riley. I am very proud of my grandfather and also the brave soldiers who fought for Australia.
My name is Camille Oddsey. I'm here to tell you about my grandfather, Arnold James O'Neill. He was born in 1922 and died in 1994. He fought in World War II. Like many others, my grandfather put his age up so he could serve in the forces. My grandfather did not talk of the war as he had too many painful memories. He told us he went to a number of places. He recalled Bethlehem and New Guinea. There is one story that I will never forget. He became a very good friend to a man which was later killed in battle. While they were in battle when shots rang out and his friend dropped to the ground to protect himself, my grandfather stayed standing. The bullets killed Grandpa's mate and my grandfather was shot through the left arm. Carried the scar to his death. I am very proud of my grandfather and other soldiers who served in the forces.
My name is Jay Reed. I'm here to tell you how proud I am of my father who went to war in 1969 as a radio operator. My dad's name is Robert Clarence Reed and his badge number was 2789649. He fought in the Vietnam War for 12 months and returned home safely. My dad told me that every morning he would get up before light and get armed in case of early attack. They would then walk through the jungle. He could spend up to 5 weeks in the jungle, then would be picked up by helicopter and taken to base for 4 days of R&R. This he did for 12 months. He returned home safely to the arms of his girlfriend and future wife. My dad was in the C Company Battalion. They were one of Australia's most successful battalions in Vietnam. They were called the Tigers. I am very proud of my dad.
I'm here on behalf of Miss Louise Roberts, who has given me the honour to tell you about the pride she has in her grandfather. W.E. Roberts was a Red Cross Society worker through the war. He was taken prisoner of war and was released in 1945 from Chiang Hai prison camp. William Edward Roberts enlisted in the Australian Infantry Force on the 8th of December 1914. He was a member of the Blair Anzacs, who landed at Gallipoli. Private Roberts was injured and spent the rest of the war recovering in England. William Roberts wanted to participate in World War II as well, and enlisted on the 3rd of March 1941. He had to backdate his age 10 years, as he was too old to legally enlist. He became a Sergeant Major with the Red Cross and was reported missing on the 13th of April 1942. He was interned at Chiang Hai Prisoner of War Camp until the end of the war. It was here that he assisted the medical work of fellow prisoner Sir Edward Geary Dunlop. William Roberts returned to Australia and died of old age in 1967.
I'm here on behalf of Cody McNamara and I'm honoured to be able to speak to you about his great-grandfather, Douglas Alfred Newman. Douglas Alfred Newman was born in 1921 and came from Emperor. He put his age up to enlist in the army, just like so many other soldiers. He belonged to the 4th Infantry Battalion and joined up in 1941. He was following in his father's footsteps as his father had fought in Europe in the World War I. After serving 18 months, he completed his last post in New Guinea. He came back to the job that he left to join the army as a painter and a builder. He retired a painter at the age of 65. Douglas Alfred Newman passed away at 67 years of age. Cody has been very honoured to be named after his great-grandfather, Douglas Alfred Newman, and is named Cody Douglas McNamara.
My great-grandfather was 17 when he joined up for the army in 1914. He defied the army sergeants who were doing the enlisting as he had not reached the correct age for going to war. His name is George Frederick Doherty, and he was placed in the medical corps as he had done first aid training as a teenager. He saw the ravages of war when the maimed and dying soldiers returned to the Red Cross medical tents. He gave out cigarettes, comfort, dress runes, and prayed for the dying. His medical ship was in the water off Gallipoli when the troops landed on the beach. He remained on the ship tending to the soldiers that returned. George Doherty returned to Sydney as a young man who had seen the horrors of war and then had to adjust to normal life.
Good morning. We have come together to recognise our brave servicemen and women. I am here to express how proud I am to be a descendant of Sergeant John Edgar Thomas, who was born in 1891 and signed up for World War I in June 1915. He also served his country in World War II. My great-grandfather and his brother James were one of the elite Australians who were the first set foot on Gallipoli soil. He was part of the 25th Battalion serving on the front line trenches, on the machine guns, and in a tank labelled MTHISTO. This original tank can now be found in a museum in Brisbane. While serving in France, my great-grandfather single-handedly brought back 10 German soldiers to the Australian camp. He received the Medal of Valour, the British War Medal, the 1914 and 1915 Star Medal, and finally the Victory Medal. With the movement of their battalion, he was placed in Egypt, where he found the experience of walking within the pyramids period. In 1970, he was wounded after a nearby shell burst and his machine gun fell on top of him and buried him deep in the trenches. He was then picked up and moved to a field hospital, not very far away from the action of the war, to be treated. There, the soldiers were treated and then sent directly back into the trenches. He was very proud of being a soldier and the magic experience of the wars. He was a soldier through and through. I was told at all the Anzac parades during the last post, he always shed a tear for his lost brother and comrades.
Three of my four grandparents served their country in the war for our peace and happiness. My grandfather, Frank John Russell, was born in 1918. He had a service number as well as a POW number. He belonged to the Private Infantry Unit, Anti-Tank 3rd. He served from Wellington, New Zealand, 22 years of age, and became a corporal in 1940. He was taken prisoner in 1941 at Kalamata. He marched to Yugoslavia and was imprisoned at Maribor Stalag, 1880. He was then moved to a work camp in Seville, Australia in 1943. My grandfather was freed in 1945. He was sent home by Italy and Liverpool. He was discharged in November 1945. My grandmother, Fiona Maureen Crane, was a rent driver in the Navy. Her service number was 635. She served between 1945 and 1947. My other grandfather, Norman Burns Finlayson Sullivan, was born in 1908. His service number is 40137. My grandfather was in the 19th Army Troop with 5th Reinforcement. He was with the New Zealand Expeditionary Forces. He was called up in 1941 at the age of 33 and sailed from Wellington to the Middle East. He returned to New Zealand in 1944 and was discharged in 1945. My grandfather passed away in 1981 at the age of 73.
I am here on behalf of Miss Louise Roberts, who has given me the honour to tell you about the pride she has in her uncle, Frederick John Roberts. Frederick John Roberts enlisted in the regular army when he left school at the age of 16. He performed so well, he was placed in the Special Air Service, SAS, who are the elite soldiers. He was sent to Vietnam at the beginning of the conflict to participate in special operations. He returned home 2 years later. Frederick Roberts remained in the army and, due to his battle experience, was promoted to surgeon in the SAS. He returned to Vietnam to serve a second tour of duty in a command position. Frederick Roberts returned to Australia uninjured and received a Distinguished Conduct Medal, and today lives with his family in Western Australia.
Thank you.
They shall grow not old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them, lest we forget.
Will the assembly please turn to the east? Today we remember them with thanksgiving, those who made the supreme sacrifice for us in time of war. We pray that the offering of their lives may not have been in vain. Today we dedicate ourselves to the cause of justice, freedom and peace, and for the wisdom and strength to build a better world. Could the official party and assembly please face the front and remain standing. New representatives and ASPA representatives will now make their presentation to Mr. Merindal on behalf of our school.
Presentation of a cheque to the Moree Technical High School Library from the Moree RSL sub-branch.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. My congratulations to the SRC, Mr. Souza, for the ceremony today. She began this last year and has equaled that this year. Thank you to the Assembly for living up to the expectations that we have come to understand from our group of students, and you have my admiration. Thank you to the official party to attend this ceremony, and thank you to our commentators for their great efforts in running the whole show. At this stage, I would thank you for the flowers from each of the SRC groups, and I would invite our guests and our SRC to come with me across the road through the school and into the memorial at the town library, where we will lay those flowers in memory of our people who have served and lost their lives in this great tradition. I would also invite any students who wish to march with us on Wednesday, April 25th, when we'll assemble down in Rocket Park and we'll be marching through the streets to Velo Square. We always run a ceremony, a march from the school, which has been fairly well attended, but it's because it now lies in our school vacations, it is often hard to remember to be there. So if you can be there in uniform, we would greatly appreciate it. I'll now move over to the War Memorial.